Hey, it's Sid, and welcome to the Nordic Model. Today I wanted to take a quick couple of minutes to explore why the case for building a long-lasting welfare state based predominantly or solely on taxing the rich, or progressive taxation, is not a great idea. The case generally for taxing the rich is that there's an obscene amount of market income that is funneled directly into the hands of a select few. While this is true, and it is also true that short-term welfare goals can be met through a more progressive marginal tax or wealth tax, in the long term, this isn't a viable solution to building a welfare state. Why? Let's look at the Brunig argument for the trilemma that we face. We as social democrats want three things. One, a large welfare state. Two, progressive taxation with the rich facing a much higher tax rate, and three, less market and capital income going to the rich. The problem is that these three things are contradictory. Large welfare states are good, but if the rich are facing a higher tax rate and you have less market income going to them, what you're trying to do is increase taxes on a shrinking bucket of income. This isn't exactly conducive to expanding the welfare state. We can't be dependent on the existence of billionaires to fund a welfare state, because let's face it, billionaires already hold an inordinate amount of social and political capital, and we want as few of them as possible. So, what is the solution to this? Well, this is where I want to bring up something surprising. When we think about robust welfare states, and by that we mean decommodifying ones that help people maintain a livable income outside of the labor market, we talk about Scandinavian states like Norway and Finland and Sweden. But did you know that America has a more progressive taxation system than these states? What this means is that we need to start assessing welfare states based on their relative redistribution and not primarily their method of taxation. Let's use friend of the model David Sliger's example for how this works. Let's pretend that we live in a society with two people, one that makes $300,000 and one that makes $30,000. We can classify the one that makes $300,000 as rich and the one that makes $30,000 as poor. First, let's look at what happens when we have a progressive tax, where the rich person pays 0.5% of their income, and the poor person pays 0.05% of their income. And we have a flat redistribution scale where they both receive 50% of the total revenue raised. As you can see, no one's really that much better off. The rich person is slightly worse off, and the poor one is marginally better off. Now, let's take that tax and make it flat. Both people pay 15% of their income, and let's keep the redistribution flat too. Both people get 50% of the tax revenue back. In this case, the poor person is much better off after the tax. They go from $30,000 in disposable income to $50,250 in disposable plus the redistributed income, while the rich person is marginally worse off at $279,000. Okay, let's take this a step further. Let's tax regressively, as in we'll make the poor person pay a greater portion of their income as taxes at 30% than the rich person at 20%, and then we'll keep the redistribution flat. The poor person is now even better off than before. They've got an 85% increase in post-tax and transfer compared to the 67% that they're getting before. This was with a regressive tax and a flat transfer. Now, to really bring the point home, let's tax regressively and also spend regressively. We'll give the rich person 60% of the tax revenue and the poor person 40% of the tax revenue. And somewhat counterintuitively, the poor person is even better off than before. This is the way that we should be looking at taxation. How can we raise the most revenue to fund generous welfare? And the answer doesn't lie where we usually think. Turns out that broadly taxing everyone and then redistributing generously leaves us all better off than highly taxing a select few to build a welfare state. There's a couple more arguments we can make here. Taxing broadly is efficient. We're able to reduce the elasticity of taxation, which means that as we increase our tax rates, we're not going to see huge drop-offs in the amount of revenue that we collect. Another one that was made by Corpy and Palm in 1998 is that the more we target the benefits at the poor through a conceivably progressive tax and transfer system, the less likely that we are to reduce poverty and inequality. Our goal in the end is to build a large welfare state. We want one that people are proud to pay into because it helps them materially. And this makes it easier to keep adding new modalities to the welfare state as it grows. This can only be accomplished through broad taxation. While in the short term, progressive taxation is a viable strategy to increase the salience of the welfare state, we should remember that it is only an opportunity to start taxing more broadly, not just more progressively.